What is that you have learned so far? You know what is an EER diagram, entity relationship modeling. You have learned the basics of EER. You understood why EER. And then we went into so many different parts in an EER diagram. Entities, attributes, types of attributes, relationships, cardinality. And then what else we have learned? We understood how to convert an EER diagram to a relational schema. So we know all these concepts. Today we are going to look at enhanced entity relationship modeling. It's sometimes called as extended entity relationship modeling or EER modeling. So what is this EER modeling? EER stands for enhanced entity relationship or extended entity relationship. So it focuses on these things. It includes all modeling concepts of basic entity relationship diagram. And additionally to those basic concepts, we are going to have subclass, superclass relationships defined. We are going to learn what is specialization, generalization, and then we are going to learn union, what is the use of union category. And we are going to talk about attribute and relationship inheritance. So that is the first step. We are going to understand extended entity relationship modeling, and then we are going to see how to convert this extended diagram to a relational schema. So why we go for extended entity relationship modeling? Because they help us in modeling applications more completely and more accurately. That's one of the reasons. And another important thing that you have to know is extended entity relationship includes some object-oriented concepts such as inheritance. So while modeling, we want to have some of the object-oriented concepts in our diagrams. So EER helps us with that. So we'll start off with the superclasses and subclasses. What is that we have seen here? So you take any entity for an organization. We talked about employee entity, right? When we say employee, it's a very broad term. You can group employees into subcategories. So what are those subcategories? For instance, I have given some subcategories here. Secretary is an employee. Engineer is an employee. Technician is an employee. So you have different categories of employees in an organization. And that can be because of the kind of job that employee performs in that organization. Or it can be grouped into a category just because of certain conditions inside that organization. So, an employee will have subcategories. You all agree. And for each category of employee, there can be specific attributes for that particular category. So here we are talking about three categories. One is based on the employee's job, we are categorizing them as secretaries, engineers, technicians. And those who are managing departments, we call them managers. And based on the method of payment, we can call salaried employees and hourly employees. So you can have subcategories for your employees. So these subcategories are called as subclasses. Secretary is a subclass, whereas employee is a superclass. Secretary is an employee. Engineer is an employee. So it's pure inheritance here. Is a relationship. So how you go and represent this kind of an inheritance relationship in EER modeling is, it's shown on the diagram here. This is from your textbook, Fundamentals of Database Management Systems by Elmas Free and Arte. So you represent the employee entity, and employee itself has got some subclasses. So you draw a line, you don't worry about this B given here, a circle, and then this is the notation you have to give to say these are subclasses, secretary, technician, engineer, manager, and then other two classes are salary and hourly employees. So you can categorize employees based on various factors. One is based on the method of payment, we say salary or hourly employees. based on the kind of job they perform, we have categorized them. So that is the definition of superclasses and subclasses. You understood what is a superclass, what is a subclass here? So employee is the superclass, whereas all those things you are seeing here, secretary, technician, engineer, manager, these are called subclasses. They are subcategories of employee type. So how can you categorize employees at VIT? You say employees for VIT, but there are so many different employees for VIT. So what are the different job types you have here? You have here professors, data entry operators, clerks, gardeners, drivers. There is also one more category of employees I have thought about. One is deans. So they are only managing schools. That is one category of employees. And permanent and contract employees. So some faculty members are permanent faculty members, whereas some are on a contractual basis. After 3 years, their contract terminates. So you can categorize an entity. So what is that entity you are looking at? Employees based on various factors. So all these subcategories become your subclasses. So we have seen this. Each is a subclass of employee. Employee is the superclass of each of these subclasses. So what are these superclass-subclass relationships? Employee secretary, employee technician, employee manager, employee professor, employee gardener, employee data entry operator. So you have a lot of inheritance relationship here. So they are also called EER relationships. So if you have understood inheritance in object-oriented programming, this is plain simple. The subclass member is the same entity in a distinct specific role. An entity cannot exist in the database merely by being a member of the subclass. Do you all agree? I can't be a professor, I can't take up the role of professor before being an employee, right? I should be an employee to be a professor in the university. So I can't exist only in the subclass. So a member of the superclass can be optionally included as a member of any number of its subclasses. A salaried employee who is also an engineer belongs to two subclasses. So here you can talk about a superclass instance being part of two subclasses. Say a professor is a dean. You agree? When you talk about an employee, you have two categories of employees, professors and deans. Whereas a professor is also a dean. So an instance of the superclass occurs in two subclasses. That is possible. So when you talk about an employee, that is the superclass, you will have two subclasses, right? So this instance can be a professor, it can also be a dean. So that says that a superclass can be optionally included as a member of any number of its subclasses. So you can take a further look. A salaried employee is a manager, is an engineer, and is also a salaried employee. Let me go to this example here. So if you talk about this employee, you take any employee, that employee can be an engineer, he can also be a salaried employee, and he can also be a manager. A manager who is an engineer and who is also a salaried employee. So it occurs in all these three subclasses, that is allowed. So now we are going to talk about inheritance relationship among the superclass and subclass entities. All attributes of the superclass is inherited by the subclass. And all the relationships of the superclass is inherited by the subclass. So what I mean by this, all attributes are inherited by the subclass. Let me show you with an example here. Say employee is the superclass. So you have employee here. And as an employee, it is mandatory for me to work for a school. So I have a relationship for an employee defined. Whereas employees are subcategories, right? Who are the subcategories of employees? Employees can be professors. Let us take only two roles, deans. So if an employee has a name and ID, all the employees have name, all the employees have ID, right? So when I say name and ID is an attribute of the employee, name and ID is inherited by professor entity too. A professor will also have name and ID. A dean will also have name and ID. So it inherits all the attributes of the superclass. The next important thing is, if employee works for department, if I define this relationship for a superclass, a dean should also work for the school, a professor should also work for the school. So all the relationships of the superclass are also inherited by the subclass. So that's what is the meaning of this particular concept. So we are going to talk about the next thing. The first thing was superclasses, subclasses, inheritance. Are you all clear with that? The second thing is specialization and generalization. So this talks about the strategies that you follow for grouping employees into categories or grouping entities under some subclasses. So let us take a set of employees. Say you have a set of employees in your organization. You are going to take the list and then you are going to find some subgroups. So, you are going to take the entire list and then you are going to find some subgroups. So, this kind of breaking a big list into sublists, you call that to be specialization. You take the entire list, you apply some factors, you say mode of payment and then you categorize it. So, it's breaking a bigger list into smaller list. So, how many groups of subclasses you can have depends on the number of factors you have for categorization. Okay. So that is simply called as specialization, and here they have given an example for an employee based on the method of payment. You can call them salaried employee or hourly employee. So you are breaking an employee entity set into two subclasses using this concept, method of payment, or using this attribute, method of payment, and that is called specialization. So how you denote specialization? Employee, you have this line and circle and then this kind of a notation. So this is specialization. Generalization. What is generalization? It is the opposite of specialization. So it literally means the same, but it's just a reverse. So you take an example here. You take two different entities, cars and trucks. And let me directly go to the example. So they take the entities and then they find the common attributes in these entities. So for a car, you have vehicle ID, license plate number, price. For a truck also, you have price, license plate number and vehicle ID. You see here, we have now got car and truck and we have superclass vehicle identified for car and truck. So how did we identify the superclass? Using our subclasses. So this is called generalization. The notation for generalization is the same as specialization. In some books, maybe the arrow mark may be reversed like this, but in our textbook, there is no difference between how you represent a specialization or a generalization relationship. Okay. So again, with respect to specialization, there are three types of specialization. Predicate defines specialization, attribute defines specialization, and user defines specialization. Only the terms are very big, but the concepts are very simple. So what do you mean by specialization? You have a list of employees, you group them under subclasses using some criteria. Here when I say predicate defined, under some condition, I group the employees. I have a condition. If their age is greater than 40, you put them under one subclass. The age is less than 40, you put them under one subclass. I define some predicates. Using those predicates, I will have subclasses. That becomes predicate defined specialization. The next type of specialization is attribute defined. Say you have this employee superclass. For that employee superclass, you have an attribute job type. So, using this attribute, you are going to find subclasses. Say, if the job type is secretary, he is one subclass. If the job type is technician, he is another subclass. If the job type is engineer, he is another subclass. So, you are going to use the attribute of the superclass to find your subclasses. So, that is attribute defined specialization. The third point is, concept is user defined specialization. You really don't have any condition or attributes. It's purely the user defines it. I take four employees, I put them in one department, I give them a subclass name. There is no criteria here. User, finalizes what should be the subclass.
Okay.
So here you are going to learn very, very important things, that is constraints on specialization and generalization. There are two types of constraints, disjointness constraint and completeness constraint. So we are going to understand what is this disjointness constraint. An entity can be a member of at most one of the subclasses in the diagram. So, if you take a specialization, the superclass instance can be present in only one of the subclasses. And that is called disjointness constraint. So, I will give an example, then you will understand. You take an employee, he can be either a secretary or a professor, but he can't be a secretary and a professor. An employee can exist as a secretary in one subclass or as a professor in another subclass, but he cannot exist in both the subclasses. So, these two subclasses are disjoint, totally different. You take the list of secretaries, they will not be present in the list of professors. If you take the list of professors, they will not be part of list of secretaries. They are totally two independent sets. So, you then say the subclasses of secretary and professors are disjoint. That is the disjointness constraint. And we have another constraint too, that is overlap. Overlap is the opposite of disjoint. So, what is this overlap? I have an example for an overlap. A professor can be a dean too. So, you take an employee, it's very simple, you just take an employee. We have so many employees and say you have two subclasses. One is the subclass of professors, one is the subclass of deans. Say I have three faculty members here, Sam, Ram and Tom. So they are the employees of DIT and say Sam and Ram and Tom are all professors. So they will be here in this list of professors, Sam, Ram and Tom. So they are all professors, whereas Sam is also dean. So Sam will be here too. So, an instance of the superclass can exist in one or more of the subclasses. So, there is an overlap here, right? Sam is here, Sam is also here. So, you call that to be an overlap. Earlier thing, disjointness is, there is no overlap. If I am a secretary, I will not be a professor. If I am a professor, I will not be a secretary. So, these two sets will not overlap. If you talk about this disjointness, what is the disjointness? You have an employee superclass and what are the two subclasses? You love secretary and you love professor. So, if you take three instances, Sam, Ram and Tom, secretary, if Sam is the secretary here, who will be the professors? Ram and Tom. There will be no overlap of entities in these subclasses. They are totally disjoint of each other. So, that is called the disjoint constraint. Are you clear with what is overlap, what is disjoint? And there is also a completeness constraint that's coming up, but I just want to show you how you represent disjoint in the entity relationship diagram or extended EER. So you give the EER, what that means disjoint. So a secretary cannot be a technician cannot be an engineer. That's the meaning. For overlap, I have another example here. An employee can be a teaching faculty and a research scholar too. There are faculty members who are teaching faculty. They are also research scholars in the university. So, they overlap. There will be the list of research scholars. They will be in the list of teaching faculty. How you represent overlap? You just give an O there. O means whatever that is here can overlap with whatever that is there. The two subclasses. So, what is B? What is O? How you represent disjoint and overlap? And there is one more thing that we have to understand. Completeness constraint. Total and partial. It is exactly something like total participation and partial participation that you have learned in EER diagrams. What is total participation? So I just don't show an example to understand total constraint on specialization and generalization. So you take an employee, every employee should be either a permanent employee or a contract employee. So you talk about employee to be the superclass and two subclasses. I found two subclasses for my employee categories. So the two subclasses are, one is permanent faculty and one is temporary faculty. So what do you mean by this total constraint? If you are an employee, you should be here or you should be here. You should be in one of the subclasses. It is mandatory. So all the employees will be either a permanent faculty or a temporary faculty. There will be no employee who is not part of these two subclasses. That is total constraint on your generalization or specialization relationship. So what is partial? It is the reverse of total, right? If you have a set of employees, there are a few employees who are not either permanent or temporary. How will you represent a total constraint is, you will put the superclass, you will have a double line. That means totally all the employees, and I put either permanent or temporary. The condition I will use here is disjoint. So every employee is here or he is here. What is partial? Instead of having these two lines, I am just going to have one line. So if I just put employee, there is one line, and then you will have two subclasses. Say if you take two subclasses, there are few employees who are not part of this class or that class in your system. Okay. So, the best example here can be deans, directors of schools. Say we'll have two posts. Not all employees are deans and directors, right? So, it's partial participation there. I mean partial constraints. So, what are things we have learned with respect to constraints on generalization, specialization? We learned disjoint overlap, partial and total. So, they make a mix of all these things. They come out with four different things here. Disjoint total, disjoint partial, overlapping total and overlapping partial. Very simple, we have already understood the concepts, the terminologies are just given there. What is disjoint total? I'll give an example for disjoint total. Say if there is a patient, he can be either an outpatient or an inpatient, resident patient. But all patients should be either outpatient or inpatient. If you go to an hospital, obviously you should be either an outpatient or an inpatient. So that is the condition. That is what is called total. All the patients should be either here or either there. When I say it is disjoint total, when I give a D here, what do you mean by disjoint? You can either be an outpatient or an inpatient. You can't be both, right? Outpatient and inpatient. That's the meaning there. This is an example for disjoint total. Whereas the previous one, this is an example for disjoint partial. What is partial? You have a single line here and it's disjoint. So there are other employees who are not secretaries, technicians or engineers. That's what you mean by partial. Not all employees belong to only these three subclasses. There are other employees who are maybe managers or some other post they are having in the organization. So that is disjoint partial. This is disjoint total. Likewise, for example, for overlap total, all employees can be a teaching faculty or a research scholar. So if you are an employee, you should be in one of these things. You should be a teacher or you should be a research scholar. So I have given this overlap constraint here. What does that mean? A teacher can also be a research scholar. So, for those who are still confused, say you take some employees with name SRPT. Some employees are teachers. Say S and P or S and R are teachers. And P is a research scholar. Whereas this employee T, since it's overlapping, he is a teacher, he is also a research scholar. Since this is occurring in both these places, you call that to be an overlap. And why we say it is total? Because you take SRPT, all the employees are part of the subclasses. So it is total. Overlap partial. So it just don't have that line here. It just means some of the employees are teachers, some of the employees are research scholars. But there can be other employees like clerks, managers, school secretaries who are not a research scholar or a teaching faculty. But what O means here? It means an overlap between these two subclasses. We are going to talk about the next thing, that is shared subclasses and lattices. So what do you mean by this? So it's nothing but single level inheritance and multiple inheritance. I have some examples here. Let me explain it with a diagram. That is far better. Say you have a super class, you have a subclass, you have just one level here. So this becomes a single level inheritance. So this subclass will inherit all the properties and relationships of the superclass. So if I have another subclass like this, inheriting this subclass. So this is inheriting this, this is inheriting this. So in that case, you call this to be multi-level inheritance. If you are really very confused about inheritance, you can very well, you know, go and refer to my lecture on inheritance in Java program. So I have explained everything with code and examples there if you are really confused about. So this is called multi-level inheritance. So this subclass will inherit the attributes of this class and this class. So if I have employee ID to be the attribute here and employee name to be the attribute here. So this subclass is going to have both ID and name to be its attributes. So that is multi-level inheritance. Another example for multi-level inheritance can be like this. I just give you this example. So you talk about the employees. All employees come under two categories, teaching and non-teaching in VIT. Whereas teaching, you are going to have professors and you are going to have teaching assistants. Non-teaching, you can have school secretaries, all the other categories of employees. So you talk about an employee. So here teaching staff will inherit all the attributes of employee. Professor will inherit all the attributes of the teaching staff. So this becomes multi-level inheritance. Multiple inheritance. What is multiple inheritance? Say I have two superclasses for a subclass. How can you have two superclasses for a subclass? And can you have some examples here? Yeah, I have some examples here in the next slide. Say there are certain faculty or staff who are called as teaching assistants in VIT. So these teaching assistants, actually they are professors. We call them assistant professor juniors. Whereas they are also students because they are carrying out their PhD here. So they will be taking the class, they have an employee ID, they are a professor. Whereas they will also have a student ID, they will be attending classes, taking examinations, they are also a student. So they play dual roles here. So they inherit, say if you have a student ID, this teaching assistant will have a student ID. If a professor has an employee ID, he will also have an employee ID. So they will have an employee ID, a student ID, they will also take examinations like a student, they will also teach classes like a professor. So here, this subclass teaching assistant inherits from two superclasses. So that is called multiple inheritance. And this subclass, which is inheriting from many superclasses, you call that to be a shared subclass. So this is called a shared subclass. That's what they mean. In the textbooks, they are given this example. You talk about engineering manager. He is an engineer. He is also a salaried employee. So there are two superclasses for this subclass. A subclass with more than one superclass is called a shared subclass. Let us take this example given in our books. We say the lattice here, because you have multi levels of inheritance, person, employee, and employee, faculty is an employee, and student assistant is an employee, whereas student assistants are of two types, research assistant and teaching assistant. So here one level, this is the second level, and this is the third level. So that becomes a specialization generalization lattice. Okay. Are you clear with these concepts? What is a shared subclass? What is single level, multi level inheritance within entities? And we'll see one more type, that is union type in extended entity relationship diagrams. So what is this union type? I'll directly go with an example here. The example is, we want to design a simple single level superclass subclass relationship. We want to have this, we want to create this. But there is a situation wherein to create this we need many superclasses. So out of this, any one of the single relationship will work out. So the best example I can give you is, say the owner for a vehicle can be of three types, either a person, a bank or a company. If a bank is giving you a loan, maybe the bank owns the vehicle. Or else if you are buying the vehicle on your own, maybe you are the owner of the vehicle. See, there is only a single relationship that will actually exist. But you can have three superclasses for that single relationship. So you denote such a kind of a thing with an union, that is union. So what is union? It is actually a single subclass superclass relationship. But due to situations, we have to project three superclasses or many superclasses for a subclass. But the relationship is just a single superclass-subclass relationship. For any vehicle, the owner can be either a person, a bank or a company. It can't be all those three. That is the difference between multiple inheritance and this particular concept. You take a owner, he can be a person or a bank or a company. But when you talk about multiple inheritance, it is the reverse. A teaching assistant should be both a professor and a student. Only then it is multiple inheritance. So it is like teaching assistant will be a professor and a student. Whereas here, you talk about this particular thing, union, a owner can be a person or he can be a bank or he can be a company. So there is only one subclass, superclass, single relationship there. Okay. Are you all clear with these things? Now our next thing is how to convert these things to tables. We have only four simple scenarios and with that we will be able to achieve our tables from our extended entity relationship diagrams. Let me take scenario 1. Scenario 1 is you have a superclass with three attributes, employee ID, name and phone, and there is a subclass professor, another subclass secretary. Professor has got some specific attribute, project name. Secretary has got a specific attribute, typing speed. So these attributes are called local attributes. When I say typing speed, it's very local to a secretary, not to an employee. So it's a local attribute. Project, say professors can only work on projects, then project name becomes a local attribute for a professor. So, scenario 1 is, no matter whether it is total, overlap partial or disjoint partial, you go with multiple relations for every superclass and subclass. Just create multiple relations. So, what kind of relations or tables you are going to create? For employee, you will create one table. You will have employee ID, name and phone. For professor, you will go and create a table. What are the attributes for a professor? Professor, project name. Whereas this employee ID is a foreign key mapped to this employee table. If you want to know the name of the professor, you go here, retrieve the name. What is the phone of the professor? You retrieve it from here. So there is a foreign key relationship established. For secretary, you go and create another table. You put the employee ID. What is the attribute specific for a secretary? You put that here. So again, there is a foreign key mapping from here to your employee table. So for every relation, no matter disjoint, overlap, partial, whatever it is, for every entity you create a table, whereas you have to follow this. For your subclasses, you just have the specific attributes given in that table and then you have a foreign key mapping to your superclass. Scenario 1 is fine, but one drawback of scenario 1 is you will be creating many tables. Because for every entity you are going with a table, so table count will be more. Scenario 2 is again the same example, but there is a small difference here. Here there is total and disjoint. So you have this condition that a superclass is having the total constraint and the disjoint constraint on its subclasses. Then how you are going to convert it to a table will be a little different. So when you have this kind of a relationship, you are going to go with subclass relations only. We are not going to create any parent class or superclass table. So we just don't see the result here. For professor, I will create a table, and what will be there in the professor table? I will have employee ID, name, phone number, and then the professor specific attribute project name. Next is I will go and create a table for secretary. What will be there in the secretary table? Employee ID, name, phone number, and this attribute specific for the secretary typing speed. So this scenario says you are not going to create any superclass tables. You are just going to create tables for your subclasses. And of course, when it is total, if you have 3 employees, say you have S, R and T, 3 employees, since it's total, S, R, T should be there within these subclasses. So when you create only tables for your subclasses, all your employees are covered. So that's why we don't create a superclass table here. What are the conditions to go with this scenario? Disjoint and total constraint should be there. Scenario 3. Here it is all about single table creation, and the constraint we are going to have is disjoint, and we are not worried about whether it is total or partial. So you have a superclass, you have a subclass, and then you have a disjoint constraint, no matter whether it is total or partial. What we are going to go with this is, we are going to go and create only one single table for all these entities. And we are going to create it like this. So we are going to have one table for all the entities. We will have employee ID, name, phone number, that is given here. Next, for professor and secretary, I have categorized that using this attribute job type. So I will put the job type here. This is one column I am going to add. And then typing speed for my secretary and project name for my professor. All the attributes I am going to put in the table. But this job type will tell me which attribute I am going to populate. Say for the first record, 1 Satish 2333. The job type is professor, so typing speed is null, whereas project name is DBMS. For the second entry, Ram, the job type is secretary, so he has typing speed but project name is null. So what is the advantage here? You are maintaining all the data in one single table, so retrieval can be very fast. But the problem here is you can generate lot of null values. Say there are so many local attributes for each subclass. 10 attributes for professor and 10 attributes for secretary. If he is a professor, 10 attributes will be null. If he is a secretary, again 10 attributes will be null. So that is the problem here. Let us talk about the final scenario and wind up. Scenario 4. Instead of disjoint, it is overlap. We are not worried whether it is total or partial. Instead of disjoint, it is overlap. So again here we are going to go with a single relation with multiple type attributes. So the solution is given here. What you are going to do is, since it's an overlap, a professor can be a research scholar. So there is an overlap, right? Say you have 3 employees, S, R and T. S, R are professors but not research scholars. There is one employee T who is here and who is also here. So this employee T will have a project name, he can also have a guide name. So in that case, what kind of design they are suggesting is, you put one single relation, you put employee ID, name and phone, all the attributes here. And then you have two flag attributes. One is for professor flag and research scholar flag. And then you have the attributes project name and guide name. So first entry Satish is a professor. So professor flag is a Boolean value. So you set it to 1. Whereas research scholar is set to 0. He is not a research scholar. Guide name is null. Whereas project name is PPMS. The second entry is a Ram. Ram is actually a research scholar alone. So his professor flag is set to 0. Research scholar flag set to 1. Guide name. I mean, there should be a guide name here. Say, guide name is Sat. The third entry is both a professor and a research scholar. So, what I'm going to have here, Tom is both a professor, he is also a research scholar. So, he has a guide name and he is also having a project name. So, finally, when you are going to have such a model, you are going to convert it to text types. So again, which one I should finally go with, either single relation or multiple relation, it depends on how many null values you are going to generate. So you can make a decision based on the conditions given. Is this clear? That's all about extended entity relationship modeling.